Welcome to the National Healthcare Safety Network, or NHSN, Hot Topics session. This presentation is a review of updates to the Surgical Site Infection, or SSI, protocol for 2015. This presentation only focuses on changes to the protocol. It does not cover the entire SSI protocol. The full protocol is located on the NHSN website. Since 2012, NHSN has been gradually implementing recommendations from the Healthcare Infection Control Practices Advisory Committee, or HICPAC, SSI Working Group. The goal of the changes to the SSI protocol is to bring NHSN definitions in line with those from other surgical professional organizations. HICPAC recommendations were based on input from infection preventionist, the CDC, AORN, ACS, STS, ACOG, and lastly, AAOS. The first change involves the addition of a new field called PATOS, which stands for infection present at the time of surgery. PATOS is a required field and is found on the SSI event form, not on the denominator for procedure form. Do not select this field if a patient had a history of an infection, but there was a period of wellness between the time of the preoperative condition and surgery. To select this field on the SSI form, evidence of infection must be documented perioperatively or found intraoperatively in a pre-op or intra-op note. Only select yes for the PATOS field on the SSI form if it applies to the depth of the SSI that is being attributed to the procedure. We will review some examples in the next slide. The patient does not have to meet the NHSN definition of an SSI at the time of the primary procedure, but evidence of infection or abscess present at the time of the surgery must be noted. We will present three examples of how to answer the PATOS field question. In the first example, a patient is admitted with an acute abdomen. In the OR during the exploratory laparotomy, there are findings of an abscess due to a ruptured appendix. An appendectomy is performed. The patient returns 2 weeks later and meets criteria for an organ space intra-abdominal SSI. You would select yes for the PATOS field on the SSI event form. In the second example, a patient is admitted with a ruptured diverticulum, and in the operative note, the surgeon reports multiple abscesses in the intra-abdominal space. The patient returns 3 weeks later and meets criteria for a superficial incisional SSI. You would select no for the PATOS field. There was no documented evidence of infection or abscess of the skin or subcutaneous area at the time of the procedure. In the third example, during an unplanned cesarean section, the surgeon nicks the bowel, and there is contamination of the intra-abdominal cavity. 1 week later, the patient returns and meets criteria for an organ space other reproductive SSI. You would select no for the PATOS field. There was no documented evidence of infection or abscess at the time of the C-section. The colon nick was a complication, but there was no infection present at the time of the surgery. The next update to SSI protocol is related to hip arthroplasty, or HPRO, and knee arthroplasty, or KPRO, revision procedures. Not all facilities follow these in their surveillance reporting plan, but if you do, there are some changes. A new field asks, was the revision associated with prior infection at index joint? This field is on the denominator for procedure form. If a total or partial HPRO or KPRO revision is performed, evaluate to determine if certain ICD-9-CM diagnosis or associated procedure codes were entered. You would review 90 days prior to and including the index revision procedure. If any of the specified codes on the next slide are recorded, select yes for the data field question. Was the revision associated with prior infection at the index joint? It's not necessary to review the medical record for additional details concerning the prior infection. This variable is defined by the presence of one or more of the ICD-9 CM codes associated with the Index H-Pro or K-Pro revision procedure in the 90-day preoperative period. If the original H-Pro or K-Pro was performed at an outside facility, the ICD-9 CM codes won't be available, and only codes for the index revision case should be assessed. If any of these ICD-9 CM codes are found in the patient's coded record, you will answer yes to this new field. NHSN is collecting these two new SSI data fields to enhance reporting for all HAI data. NHSN will rebaseline all HAIs based on 2015 data. New data reported to NHSN will provide the baseline for calculating standardized infection ratios, or SIRs, for 2016 and subsequent years. SIRs calculated for 2015 data will use the current baselines. SSIs reported with a PATOS as a yes will be excluded from the SSI SIRs beginning with 2016 data and the new baseline. These excluded SSIs will be available for analysis by the facility. The prior infection at index joint field will be used as a new risk factor. It will be considered in the risk adjustment models for new H-Pro and K-Pro 2015 baselines. In 2015, NHSN is providing a second method that can be used to answer the diabetes field question. Assignment of the discharge ICD-9 CM codes in the 250 to 250.93 range is acceptable for answering yes to the diabetes field question. NHSN has updated definitions of inpatient and outpatient procedures to answer the outpatient field on the SSI event and the denominator for procedure forms. This definition is no longer based on the patient being admitted and discharged on different calendar days. If the OR suite is largely intended for patients who will be admitted to an inpatient unit, then all the procedures from this OR suite will be considered inpatient procedures. The 80-20 rule for mapping locations does not apply when determining the inpatient OR suite status. For example, if an inpatient OR suite is largely intended for procedures performed on patients admitted to the hospital, all procedures performed in this OR area will be considered inpatient procedures. This is true even if some of the patients having procedures are not admitted to the hospital and do not spend a night. If the OR suite is largely intended for procedures on patients who will not be admitted to an inpatient unit, then all the procedures from the OR suite will be considered outpatient procedures. This is true even if some of the patients have procedures and spend a night in the hospital. If the facility has only one OR area and performs all inpatient and outpatient procedures in this area, it should be considered an inpatient OR. All procedures performed in this area should be reported as inpatient procedures. In 2015, the reporting instruction for answering the scope risk factor field on the denominator for procedure form has been updated. NHSN had stated that if a trocar site was extended, then the answer to the scope question should be scope equals no. This reporting instruction has been removed. The new reporting instruction found in the table of instructions is check yes if an NHSN operative procedure is coded as a laparoscopic procedure performed using a laparoscope or robotic assist. Otherwise, check no. The definition of primary closure of an incision has been simplified. The new definition states that a primary closure is defined as closure of the skin during the original surgery. Regardless of the presence of wires, wicks, drains, or other devices or objects extruding through the incision. This category includes surgeries where the skin is closed by some means. Thus, if any portion of the incision is closed at the skin level, by any manner, a designation of primary closure should be assigned to the surgery. This change removed the phrase "all tissue levels" from the definition. This phrase caused a lot of questions and confusion. This definition will be easier to apply and is closer to the definitions used by other surgical professional groups. For the non-primary closure definition found in the SSI protocol, the only change was the removal of one sentence. If the deep fascial levels of an incision are left open, but the skin is closed, this is considered a non-primary closure since the incision was not closed at all tissue levels. This sentence was removed since this scenario would now meet the primary closure definition. On review, NHSN noted that the current list of ICD-9 CM codes for appendectomy procedures does not include the code for incidental appendectomies. Therefore, in 2015, do not report incidental appendectomy procedures, since this is not one of the codes that is in the current appendectomy ICD-9 CM procedure group. Just a reminder that when an organ space SSI is evaluated, you must meet one of the criteria for the general organ space definition found in the SSI protocol. In addition, you must meet at least one criterion for a site-specific organ space infection as listed in Table 4 in the SSI protocol. For example, if a CT scan is performed and they see what may be an intra-abdominal abscess, the IP must determine if the case meets the definition of an IAB infection. These specific definitions are found in Chapter 17. All the definitions in the Surveillance Definitions chapter were reviewed and updated for 2015. Please be sure to use the new definitions in this section for applying organ space SSI criteria. For 2015, CMS has not added any new NHSN operative procedures. Coloenhist procedures are still the only two that are reported for acute care facilities participating in the CMS Hospital Inpatient Quality Reporting Program and for PPS-exempt cancer hospital reporting program. CDC continues to work on updated ICD-10, CM, PCS, and CPT mappings to all NHSN operative procedure categories for SSI surveillance. These mappings are anticipated to be available by March 2015. ICD-10 CM PCS codes will replace ICD-9 CM codes on October 1, 2015. However, NHSN will not have the ability to receive these codes until January 2016 release. The NHSN guidance for entry of surgical denominator data for the last quarter of 2015 is to enter the NHSN procedure code, for example, COLO or HIST. Do not enter any ICD-10 CMPCS codes associated with the procedure. This concludes the NHSN Hot Topic Update, focusing on the Surgical Site Infection Protocol for 2015. If you have questions, please contact NHSN User Support at nhsn@cdc.gov.